Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Clay has been a huge part of this, organizing it, presenting at it, and one of my favorite parts of the event every year is getting a chance to hear what he thinks is interesting right now. So,
thanks very much. Thank you very much. So I want to talk about, as I often do at these things, I want to talk about something I haven't talked about before since this is the home team. I'm playing around with an idea for thinking about what media speed and spread does or can do to culture, and I want to try it out on you all and then hear whether or not it's essentially what parts of it are workable and what parts aren't. So with that little introduction, let's start here with this image. So there are I want to talk about three things about this image. First, think what had to go into making this, right? To understand that this was going to be a funny image to make, you have to understand both American children's television and the curious mix of prurience and prudishness that is Japanese pornographic video, right? So that's an unusual combination right there. But the person who made this, probably a he, didn't just have to understand that. He also had to understand that you would understand that too, for those of you who were laughing. For those of you who are not, congratulations, you've wasted less of your lives than we have. So that already is interesting. That's an interesting cultural overlap. The second thing about this is you didn't just have to watch old Grover here and think, that looks orgasmic. You had to have enough video editing equipment to be able to take this image and make this adjustment to it. Even 10 years ago, that would have meant professional grade gear on your desk. You could not have done this using distributed web tools. And third, you had to be able to put this in a place where it would be distributed. I think that place was B, but of course, because you can't tell things when things are posted on 4chan if they've appeared any place before. I followed this back as far as I can. I think this first appeared on the B channel of 4chan. But you had to have a place where you could put this and it would be both widely distributed and archived. Those are three big changes. So what does that mean for the cultural environment that we live in, that an image like that can get made, can work, and that people will look at it and have the reaction that the creator knew that it would have, and third, that it will spread and persist to the point where when I wanted to look at it years after it launched, I could Google it and instantly find it. So observation two. Thinking about culture, if you're thinking about culture, one of the things you end up thinking about is what definition of it are you using? Because although we all talk about it all the time, there isn't really a good, stable, widespread definition of what it means. And in fact, in much of the sociological tradition, it is this weird entity to which all kinds of stability and importance is attached. But as Bruno Latour often says, in what room is culture produced? Right, you can't just posit that there is a thing called culture. Right, you have to talk about how it gets made. And for a long time, that challenge, Latour's challenge to the idea of culture as an entity, existed without having, I think, a good explanation. This is the closest thing I have found to a working explanation. It's Dan Sperber's book, Explaining Culture. And what Sperber does is he takes situations like this. Right, this is an ordinary Protestant church service. And just the number of things going on in this picture, the number of inputs and outputs, as it were, become really hard to track or trace. And what Sperber says is you can decompose culture into only two actions. Right? Either someone is taking a manifestation that they imagine and they are actualizing it. They are making it real. They are making it visible or audible or consumable in some way. Or someone is taking a manifestation that exists in the world and they are internalizing it. They are looking at it or listening to it. They are consuming it or they are remembering it. So in the Sperber notion, right, as Sperber himself puts it, culture is the precipitate of communication and cognition in a community, right? Culture is the precipitate of communication and cognition in a community, which is to say that the culture is the end result of all of the outputs plus all of the inputs in a live network. There is no culture where there aren't living people interacting. And of course, this means that you can start to draw these things not just as impression and expression, but actually as networks, as material passing through from one person to the next to the next. Now, oral culture, culture of people talking to one another, has all of the well-known problems, right? It can only reach people who are nearby. It only reaches people in real time and so forth. And so a representation that is expressed by someone and then listened to or acquired by someone else can be changed in the next version without anyone intentionally saying or even understanding, I misheard those lyrics and passed them on or what have you, right? So this provides a model of culture which is transactional, right? Which is about relations between people in a network. One of the great advantages of the Sperber model for thinking about culture is that it takes the idea of cultural transmission and it does away with the meme, right? There is no unit, there is no entity that gets passed, there is no analogy to DNA, right? Everything is actually about a sender and receiver. There's no point at which you can identify something that's moving through the system. It also makes it clear, and I totally stole this image from the presentation this morning. I had a different image, but I like this one better. It also makes it clear how incredibly important media artifacts are in the history of culture, because being able to encode something in an artifact, we're so used in our media environment to talk about the expressive qualities of different media, but just the basics of having something that's asynchronous, travels well, is long-lived and high fidelity, is a huge change, right? The ability to record something and have someone else see it later without you having to be there and without it having to rely on the imperfections of either human transmission or human memory is pretty remarkable. So that decomposition, everything is either expression or impression, I think respects the complexity of cultural transmission and allows for real decomposition at the same time. So you look at a situation like this and you say, there is a physical artifact here so that the material can be encoded and then handed out. Right, a hymnal is a way of making something available to anybody who wants to participate, but the ritual around it requires that be reproduced real time, right? So that if you're in a situation like this where people are singing, part of what you're getting is you're actually reading the material and you're hearing other people say it at the same time. You're synchronizing your reading and that listening. You are, of course, synchronizing and they are listening. And, of course, each of these people also has their own feedback loop of experiencing themselves saying the same thing over and over. These situations get incredibly complicated, right? These are network diagrams of insane complexity for even a small situation like this. Imagine now trying to do the culture of a New York City street. But there's the advantage of actually being able to ask yourself, is this somebody taking something that they're thinking and expressing it, or is this somebody internalizing an expression? Those networks now can be traced and can start to hold together. So I had been thinking about the Sperber book when this happened, which is I was asked to read Jonathan Franzen's book on the Karl Kraus project. Kraus is a Viennese critic in the early part of the 20th century, early and middle part of the 20th century, in order to have an onstage conversation with Kraus last fall. Well, sorry, with Franzen last fall. And Franzen and I were talking about the internet and Twitter and all the things you would sort of expect. But the passage in Franzen's book that jumped out at me was this. Franzen, famously a declinist and famously an enemy of the internet and a supporter of paper books and all of the rest of it, says, right, the great suffering I am feeling at the age of 53 is that clearly younger people are not holding dear what I held dear. And he posits this idea that if only he had been born in 1159, life would be better. Right? It is certainly the case that for the average resident of the English-speaking world, had they been born in 1159, there would be less disruption in their lives were they to make it to the ripe old age of 53. But in every other way, 1159 was a horror show. You wouldn't wish 1159 on an enemy. So I started to wonder why Franzen had picked that date as a comparison, right? Why would you pick a date like that that would weaken your point? And I realized if he'd said nothing much changed between 1859 and 1909, right? Civil War, the Industrial Revolution, right? There's the industrialization rather of the United States. You couldn't make that argument about 1859 to 1909. 1759 to 1809, Revolutionary War, there was a bunch of big changes. Working forward, if you'd said 1259 to 1309, things were moving, but again, not rapidly. The average English-speaking citizen wouldn't see that much change. And I realized the two dates were sort of converging on this, which is Luther and the Protestant Reformation. They were converging on the moment when the printing press dramatically accelerated the spread of ideas through the population. Now, the great irony here, for Franzen's point of view, Franzen is a lover of books in the manner of books smell nice, I read them in the tub, which is to say it isn't just the written material. He loves the paper, he loves the physicality, and yet it was the printing press itself that became the agent by which culture gets disrupted reliably in sub-generation timescales. So the thing that Franzen loves, which is the physical book, and the thing that Franzen hates, which is young people not believing the same things that old people believe, are causally linked in a way he isn't talking about. Because Luther was far from the first heretic. In fact, the Catholic Church was really good at dealing with heretics up to Luther. What Luther had was a faster clock speed than the Catholic Church. And that was the first time that the church had faced that particular problem. So prior to the Protestant Reformation, all good ideas came from the past, or almost all good ideas came from the past, because an idea had to be long-lived to be widespread. Right? If you wanted an idea to spread through the culture, it took so long that effectively the people who had the idea had passed away long before the idea became widespread. This was one of the first times when an idea could reach an entire generation in the lifespan of the person who had had the idea. Right? That I think, is not just a big change. I am positing that that's a fruitful way to think about media and media speed generally. So I am with some trepidation stealing a scientific metaphor to apply it to culture, which is always dangerous, but you know, as with the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, but I'm doing it anyway. So the physicists have this concept called the light cone. So if a star blows up, if a star has a nova, right, we don't see it until the light reaches us. So you can imagine another star a light year, or an observer a light year away, and another observer 2 light years away. And in the space of a year, the light moves 1 light year away from the star. One observer sees it, the other observer doesn't yet, too far away. But the disadvantage of this kind of diagram is that the horizontal axis is both space and time. Right? It's both measured in light years and elapsed years. So astrophysicists render this not as space and time, but as a cone. So they put time on the vertical axis, and they say you start to measure time on the vertical. The two observers are in the same positions, and there's a cone of light that moves outwards. A year after the event, the observer who's a light year away sees the star explode. The event happens at that moment for them. It does not yet happen for the observer 2 years away, which reminded me of something we used to say to each other in Missouri, where I grew up. We would say, if you're ever diagnosed with cancer, move to Missouri because everything happens 10 years later here, right? This is that idea, right? And in, oops, hello. 2 years later, the observers are in the same place. Now the cone has expanded so far that this action, this explosion, is in the past for this observer, whereas this observer sees it happen right at the moment. So that is a light cone. And what I'm positing is a culture cone. Right? The idea that things move through the network in space and time, but instead of using distance, you're using connectivity. There are more connected observers and there are less connected observers. When events happen, right, and I picked an arbitrary time scale, the observers are in the same place. Now it is spreading not through physical space, but through the network, right? When was the first time you heard about X, right? You could take a culture cone right now and say, when was the first time you heard the word Bitcoin and it registered? And that would measure a very particular culture cone that is currently moving through our society, right? And the same observations, right? People who are less connected experience the event as happening right there. I think it may have been Anil who was here earlier today who said the breakout year for blogging was whatever year the reporter started their own blog, right? This is a way of expressing that idea, which is to say, when a reporter says, "Oh my God, such and such has just arrived on the scene," what they mean is they just saw the Nova flash, no matter how long ago it actually started. So In a parallel now, the occupation of Tahrir Square and the ability to route around the Egyptian government, the Mubarak government's attempts to keep people from coordinating, had dynamics similar to Luther's dynamics, which is to say there were tools that allowed the protesters' clock speed to be higher than the clock speed of the regime that was trying to stop them. And so you start looking at media speed not as an absolute speed, but as a comparative speed. There was, in the conversation about the use of, particularly of mobile phones, the observation, oh, but there were revolutions before there were mobile phones, therefore mobile phones can't have mattered. That might make sense if the only thing that mattered was absolute speed. But if the relative speed of reaction between incumbents and insurgents matters, then an increase in speed could create new dynamics, even if there had been similar dynamics before, because it becomes a comparative speed rather than an absolute speed. So, to end this and move to question and conversation, here roughly is the idea I am playing with. As I said, prior to the modern world, dated from the 1500s, the idea of modernity as Protestant Reformation and onwards. The core feature of modernity is that an idea no longer has to be long-lived to be widespread, right? That someone can have an idea that rapidly synchronizes a population at the same time. This means, in some way, looking past the traditional, at least American, frame of reference where freedom of speech and freedom of assembly are different freedoms. Because if a freedom coordinates groups of people, it is closer in spirit to freedom of assembly than freedom of speech. We often regard freedom of speech as an individual right to both hear and speak, but the ability to get the same idea moving in the same group at the same time creates a coordination value that's closer in spirit to freedom of assembly. So in 1159, the cone was narrow, right? But the big difference, and this is where I don't know if the metaphor is helpful or harmful, the big difference between a light cone and a culture cone is that the speed of light never changes, right? The speed of cultural spread has changed dramatically. So by the time you move to 1559, right, in the middle of the early print, actually the century into the print revolution, the cone is wider, right? Material moves faster, but there are also more producers of cones, which is to say the Catholic Church no longer enjoys a relative monopoly on the written material, which is to say the long-lived, spreadable artifacts that get produced. Now, all of a sudden, the secular category of publishers can produce all of these kinds of things. And of course, you know, move ahead to now, right, and you get a world where the cones are wider, which is to say things spread faster, This is how someone who wants to make a satirical animated GIF about an American children's television show can count on a large enough audience also being part of these same cones. But the other thing is the number of producers of these cones, which is say the number of producers of ideas that can spread, has also seen another dramatic increase. So this is what I'm playing with, and I want to throw out at the end of this before conversation a couple of potential ramifications of this. The wider a culture cone is, which say the faster it spreads through a larger network, the less difference there is between subcultures and culture, right? Culture is just the largest possible subculture, but there will be subcultures all the way down, which say there's no big gap anymore between the widest possible syndication of ideas and things that are slightly more syndicated. High culture used to mean, or high in a world where public expression is both difficult and expensive, high culture was, and almost all culture metaphors are positional, subculture, high culture. High culture was the ability of the elites to decide in advance what would get distributed. High culture comes under real pressure when the world looks like this, because the ability to sort out what someone has decided to distribute at high cost versus what someone is distributing using the existing social networks, it's not impossible to hash it out, but it becomes harder. This alarms elites. One of the things that's true of this, and I got this from reading Ethan's book, homophily, the limit of spread in this network is homophily, not geography and not cost. In Ethan's telling, and he talked actually a lot about this last year, there's a network of connections. Our network of connections is the most cosmopolitan network of connections that has ever existed in human history. And there was a network of flows which looks like a high school dining room, right, where we all cluster with the same people who are just like us and we never talk to anybody weird. And the gap between networks of connectivity and networks of flow is the big limiter here. So now we've had a media environment which, for a whole bunch of engineering accidents, has been, even when we were able to send radio waves through the air, it's been highly, highly geographically limited, because the crappy state of radio engineering in the first third of the 20th century meant everybody went for transmitters that would broadcast only to 50 or 100 mile radii. Now we have a truly global network, and we still have an extraordinarily local set of communications because of homophily. This network also privileges Marco Polo figures like Ethan, who are able to do things like he did last year and get up and say, okay, now I'm going to tell you about the time that one Mongolian guy came into the sumo wrestling league, right? Those kinds of changes aren't a function of the network. The availability of that's a function of the network, but the actual cosmopolitan activity is a who rather than a what, to take the language from earlier this morning about big data and about privacy. And the last thing is the great predictor of elite access in a network like this is not has access to information, does not have access to information. That was true in 1159, that was true in 1559. In a network like this, the great elite advantage is has access sooner versus has access later. If the culture cones really spread like this, eventually everybody gets some sense of what's happening, and there's lots and lots of overlap. But if you're hearing about Bitcoin up here versus if you're hearing about Bitcoin down there, that translates into real potential financial advantage. Anybody who just for the hell of it bought 5 Bitcoins 2 months after they had appeared has, if they have done nothing else since, benefited enormously from being in the top part of the cone instead of the bottom part of the cone. That advantage has always existed, but it is so much more vital now, in part because the other limitations of the other kinds of cones have shrunk. So with that, I'll stop and see if there's any questions.
Gina.
Friendly modification.
Yes, great.
What was
Oh, all right. Interesting.
It's dependent upon
density.
The media.
That's
great.
Interesting.
It's
yes.
Dependent upon the medium, right?
Just yep. Great.
And then my second friendly modification is, so you've got a transmission model in here that's really tightly dependent upon sense. And I want to push you to think about that. Because this idea of the transmission of culture from Sperber is about something that kind of thrown out a little bit in communication, which is, does it have to be intelligible?
Interesting.
So you've got a model here that is about encoding and decoding without any complication in between.
Yes, yeah.
And frankly, what we know is literally these culture cones, which are like a concept, is that it is about in the interpretation and sometimes the misinterpretation.
Right.
So this stuff doesn't have to be right.
Right. Interesting.
Right?
Right, right.
So there's a semiotician, Blotman, who's thought a lot about if communication, if we ever make sense, like, right?
Right.
I say garbly-gook, and you hear garbly-gook, and then you take it to mean what you need it to mean.
As Bernard Shaw once said, the really dangerous thing about communication is the illusion that it has taken place. Yeah, that's interesting. And actually, one of the things I didn't talk about, because I've been co-letting positional metaphors. So what is high culture over, what is a subculture under, but also what is an in-joke in?
Right.
And the question of intelligibility, in-jokes are things that are almost always designed to be not intelligible without some degree of socialization. So you are really joining an intentionally, you have to fairly intentionally join a dense part of the network in order to get an in-joke because you the movement to being inside. That is tremendously helpful. Thank you. I will also take happily unfriendly emendations as well. Yes.
Right. Have to deal with as researchers because it's complex. And on the one hand, we need society, we need culture, we need community. On the other hand, that's the thing
that's interesting.
Yeah,
so I'm thinking about Gina's idea of density too. When E.O. Wilson wrote Sociobiology, one of the things he said was, the species concept, the modern species concept, is you identify a species by figuring out what the border of sharply reduced gene flow is. And Wilson said, I am looking for borders of sharply reduced information flow. So within a culture, you could almost say within a culture, information flow is high. And between cultures, it's lower. So that you would be looking at two different densities of cultural transmission, which is one of the things that makes long hop figures, people who live in one culture and then take that information into another culture, so important, because that information flows at a molasses-like rate without those people. They're almost catalytic of culture. Yeah, Ethan.
Still going to talk about Tahrir, which I know a little bit about. It's not just the ability of people to share information faster than the government.
Right.
It's the ability to share it very widely. So it's not just the mobile phone metaphor, it's the having it show up on broadcast media metaphor.
Yep.
And the reason for that is that the importance isn't just that you're coordinating people's actions. And this is where I felt like you went a little astray in your first book. It's people being able to do preference falsification along the lines of Timur Kuran by sort of saying, oh, you're against Mubarak, and I see that you're also against Mubarak, and I can see that these other people are against Mubarak. It actually fits the cultural cone model very nicely, because there's that moment, one light you're in, where you can sort of say, oh, you get it, that's gone supernova, and you can see that someone else has not seen it go supernova. And so I think that question about culture as awareness of who else shares that culture with you at the point is incredibly important on the political mobilization piece of it. Second thing, really fast. Where I'm hoping you're going to push on this is beyond the speed question and into the filtering question.
Yes.
So you're right that speed is a critical component of this, but your closing example doesn't quite work. There's a lot of us who saw Bitcoin 2 months after it came out and went, wow, that's another crazy crack brain scheme that I'm not going to
get.
And our issue there wasn't that we didn't have the information in time, it was that we couldn't filter down to which culture, now that everyone is shining these lights, was worth my time and my attention by buying into. Now, fortunately, filtering is where you've probably been smarter than almost any other thinker on it, so I'm sure you're going to work that one out. But to me, that seems a little missing from the problem.
Yeah, no, thank you. And
exactly the same thing, which is why I've now put all of my retirement income into Dogecoin. So I missed the first one, but I'm on the next wave. Let me also say about your other point. Emily Parker has a book coming out in about four weeks now called Now I Know Who My Comrades Are, which is about the internet and repressive regimes, Cuba, Russia, China. And what she concentrates on is not the large-scale information cascades, the Susan Lohman Leipzig story and so forth. She concentrates on the psychological change of people who have the thing you always hear, which is, I thought I was the only one. And it's the thing, Ethan, you were talking about, which is, oh, you're actually talking about hating Mubarak too. I thought I was the only one. Tricia, and then.
Yes. Well, there's a famous study
about otaku culture where if people are talking about something on Thursday that other people knew about on Tuesday, you have lost face in that group. So there, the relative speed comparisons remain in place, but the absolute speed of at which point you're expected to process new information about the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers or Pokemon or what have you, just the whole thing just increases. But the insider-outsider tension remains in place. That's who was it, Lee? Great, thank you, Steve.
I'm interested in how we take this as a model looking forward, because it's drawing in retrospect.
Yeah.
That you have, you know, a series of plots on a line that have happened in order for them to have a relationship with you.
Yep.
They have to have already happened.
Yep.
So looking forward, we're looking at potential. And what the disruptors are to that potential, I find really interesting. The example about the clock speed of information response in an oppressive regime, and the way that has in a couple of instances been disrupted by the people who were in power just buying information. They're actually using enormous capital protect power to get black hat hackers to come onto their side and do what they need to do. And so that all of a sudden any model that has a speed that is retrospectively defined. Suddenly messed up because moving forward everyone's going to speed. And the speed is changing as we're going forward.
Yeah.
And so anything that's relative between two entities is corruptible going forward. And so I suppose it's just the potential for being able to predict those things. It's infinitely more complex than what we can see from past performance.
Yeah. So this is I just flipped this upside down, but there's another aspect to the light cone model, which could apply here too, which I didn't talk about, which is
you are always at every moment standing at the apex of all possible things that could have gotten to you so far. And one way to think about that is So if you think about those two layers now, that middle layer there is your first neighborhood, right? Which is those are your tightest connections. And they can only get to things that are the accumulation of their friends and contacts and sources, which is their second neighborhood. So you can start also to talk about the inputs, right? How many culture cones am I at the intersection of from the past at this moment? And there's an amazing book by last name Boyd, I forget his first name, but who wrote the military's Bible on battle action, and his most compressed telling was the OODA loop: observe, orient, decide, act. What he says is you take a look around, you orient yourself to the situation, you decide what you're going to do, and you're going to act. And what he said is he makes the claim that across a wide range of military history, the people with the faster OODA loop tend to win. What's that? The OODA loop is Clausewitz is the dynamics come from Clausewitz, but the OODA loop was Boyd's version of this, sort of breaking down the steps, and I believe the U.S. military still uses this. There are people who can operate in very fast loops compared to, yeah. So the range of clock speeds in society is quite various now.
Search does crazy things for
language acquisition in children, because if you know fewer words, you simply, there's just giant parts of the Google corpus that you could never uncover, even if you have full access and fast internet access. Yeah, John.
It's a Jimmy Kimmel bit where he does unnecessary censorship, but I find that a lot of his stuff bubbles up to the internet.
Interesting. Okay. Interesting. Great. Thank you. All right.
Okay. It was only for geeks and losers, because it was only like people in the internet industry who were even using it when it launched, because we were willing to take a chance on anything and had the rich social lives that we famously had. But over time, it became normal, and it became normal not because they did anything, but because other monkeys went to that river and they didn't drown. Right, and that just kind of primal observation was the thing that made it happen. I just spent some time trying to figure out why healthcare.gov fucked up so bad, and I was asking the question, whose head goes on that pike staff? Who didn't tell someone in the executive office, the president, about the technological troubles? And the answer turns out to be exactly as you just said, no one, right? Techies always answer to non-techies in the entire White House structure. So the person in charge of healthcare.gov had a civilian, as it were, report. They didn't report to the CIO of HHS, or CMS, who doesn't report to the CIO of HHS, who doesn't report to the CIO of the federal government. So with no one having any ill intent at all technical value in that conversation just got squeezed out, because shit like the database gets exponentially slower at scale. Like, There's a group of people to whom that means red alert, all hands on deck, and there's a group of people who means I'll write that down, and if it comes up in the meeting, I'll mention it. And as long as it's that second group of people, the technical value of the conversation is squeezed to zero with no malice whatsoever. So, and it may well be that the cone metaphor, because it takes this kind of, you know, straight line thing, isn't right for the distortion. So that may be it. Yeah.
HCI paper that you might find very relevant to this about strategies for appearing like you're at a part of the cone that you're not. Michael Bernstein, Marcus, and others, they made something that tells you that it knows who among your friends have seen a link, and it helps you only share a link friends who haven't seen it yet.
That's really good. I'll email you and get that, Tom.
I'm not sure if I got the whole statement here, but I feel good at the medium changing transmission. When you brought up to rear at the time you did, my first thought was, well, actually that changed a lot because it actually changed the transmission itself, right? All of a sudden, you've had a sort of Verbosian phase change in connectivity of people about the ideas going on.
Yeah.
And I think what she's getting at a bit there is that as that energy moves through the cone, it does things like that. It also does things like constructive and destructive interference. And I think it's related to the quality of the event, but now I'm talking out of my ass.
Me too. I mean, speciality de la maison. But
no, I think that. But I don't mean this conference. I mean ITP, where if we understand an idea fully, it's time to move on. So, but yeah, that idea of the phase change is, I think, probably a better metaphor for the substrate than anything having to do with the speed of light. Yeah, Fred. I'm sorry.
I think it's a great speech, and the metaphor I think works because it's got us discussing things. I mean, that was the purpose.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't have to be perfect. It starts the discussion. I think a couple of things. I would probably add time bandwidth product on here.
Time bandwidth and what?
Time bandwidth product, meaning you get the information out, but it may be slow if the channel is slow. But if you've got long enough time, and I'm thinking culture takes a long time. You said it has to be concentrated, it has to be high connectivity. No, not necessarily. You've got high bandwidth. The other thing that this struck me about was building on the idea of filter. Is the idea of the time velocity of money in economics.
Yeah.
If you can turn the money over more quickly, then it becomes, I guess, like Bitcoin. So you know about Bitcoin. You learn about gold, it's got a velocity of its own, and the aggregate, it develops big. I think it's great. Mm-hmm. It's a great start. And I maybe the metaphor there is, or the analog is speed reach, because it's speed and reach simultaneously.
Well, this is the appealing thing about the light cone, which is, if I think about time in one way and space in another,
get to some of these kind of comparisons. Yeah, go on.
I think the case I would like to explain, not right now, but if you take this further, and this is to Gina's point about sense making and to Kate's point about distortion and repetition, is Gangnam Style.
Mm-hmm.
Because most people in the world don't speak Korean. But when we saw it, we knew it was something about it was ridiculous. So I was both in a cone and out of a cone at the same time. And I think about, do cones have fuzzy edges, or when Gangnam Style is released, is it actually a simultaneous release of several cones, of which I'm part of some and not part of others? So if you can explain Gangnam Style in the way that it has 2 billion views, but most people don't speak Korean, then I think you have something.
And there are 8-year-old
girls at my daughter's school who can sing the song phonetically, but have no idea what it means. And the cohort question is, will any of those students learn, like, could they learn Korean faster later, or was it just a blip, like any sort of novelty song would have been? That's a really interesting idea. And Liz, do I need to, I could talk about this all day, but I should shut up because I do have a plane to catch, but that's not the, whatever. But you've got.
I mean, we need to have people at five.
Okay.
You know, but
Okay.
I could
do this all day, but I promise I won't. Yeah. So then, instead of shutting down the hashtag, they would flood them. So you can make the complex either by shutting it off or by filling it up with so much junk, by essentially by increasing the low quality density or whatever. There's two different strategies depending on whether you can get to that light switch or not.
So I had a question about what's the code. So in some sense, like I was thinking, like with Robin Dunbar, like you got the Dunbar number. If you only paid like 150 people, and this is a million years of evolution. Like that's just the size of our tribes, and so like that's all we can pay attention to. And so the code is getting wider, but like our brains haven't changed in that way to like let us keep track of more people. Over the last 800 years, so what's changed to let these cones become bigger? I mean, this gets back to like the construction of like what this culture is. I mean, so if we can only pay attention to like 150 people, but now we've got bigger cones, like what changed?
So to go back to friends, and you know, I think I don't disagree with his argument. I
find him unduly pessimistic about it, but he would argue that things go away faster too. That when we amp up the exposure function, we also amp up the decay function. Precisely because the cognitive limits have not budged in a network where the speed, which is to say both the time and the width of accessibility, have dramatically increased. The other thing that's happened is there's a couple of different forces for this, but it is almost impossible in America now to pretend that there is a mainstream culture that largely holds the same views about most things. Right? And that has been breaking down for 15 or 20 years. But the internet means that we now know what other people think, and this has just been a huge, huge disappointment. And that, like that awareness, right? The best tweet ever of the week was, you can be taught to hate, and you can be taught to spell, but it's one or the other, apparently, right? I mean, that recognition of the kinds of opinions that you would find horrifying that other people express regularly and vice versa, we can see that now. So I think another thing that breaks down is partly the fact and partly the illusion of real cultural density when there isn't, at least in a society like ours.
So I love the talk. One thing that immediately popped to my mind was Matt really talked about idea sex, where two ideas meet. Mm-hmm. And as a moment of possible innovation, technical, cultural, societal. So all these idea cones, every time they're intersecting, it's a possible sort of a new cone heading off in random directions right there. And there's empirical data backing it up in, to some extent. Like cities are appear to be n-squared with density, with rate of innovation, countries appear to be as well. So there's some of these facts.
So I love that combinatorial stuff, but I spent
10 years trying to make memes make sense. And part of what the reading the Sperber did for me was to say there's a transactional model that doesn't assume a unit of encoding or transmission. So the problem with idea sex, as evocative as it is, you know, in a way that's a metaphor that invites the DNA comparison that Dawkins introduced, but that I think is wrong. I think Sperber's got the better idea, which is to say that it's all transactional. And that when the interpreter goes out of scope, when the interpretation goes out of scope, that culture ceases to exist, right? We can recognize Petra, or the Great Pyramid of Cheops, as entrance into their respective cultures, but are not part of, but that culture's gone because those transactions are gone. And now they've become tourist icons rather than objects of religious veneration. They still exist, they still have meaning, but the meaning changes with the underlying group. I think there was one, talking to the mic, yeah, sorry, Rob. Anyway, thank you all. This is really helpful. I can't thank you enough.